protection and there's peace to sustain. Burn in your ticket for that long black train. But you know there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. I came to the Father and his soul in aid. And don't go riding on that long black train. There's an engineer on that long black train, making wonder if the ride is worth the pain. He's just waiting on your heart to say, let me ride on that long black train. But you know there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and his soul in aid. And don't go riding on that long black train. Stay away. That train is beauty, making everybody stare. But its only destination is the middle of nowhere. But you know there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and his soul. Brother, pull that long black train. That devil's driving that long black train.
Amen. Good morning, Harvest Christian Center. Good morning. Amen. I want to make sure you know you are at Harvest Christian Center. Amen. I was behind the wall. I was second-guessing myself. I had to peep out, and I thought I was underdressed. I needed a cowboy hat to come out here. Amen. This is my first time hearing about the long black train. I heard about this train that was bound for glory, this train that you, the ride, you got to be holy, this train. Amen. This train that don't take no liars, no backbiters, no backsliders. I heard about that train. But y'all make sure y'all get on the right train. Amen. You get on the one that's driven by Jesus that is bound for glory. Amen. Amen. I want to welcome everyone to Harvest. You may have your seats. I want to welcome everyone to Harvest Christian Center. We're so glad that you chose Harvest as your place of worship. Amen. If you're a first-time guest, I want to say to you, welcome home. Amen. We have some old friends are here. And I want to make sure you, if you're a first-time guest, I want to encourage you to fill out a Connect card at the end of service. On your way out, there should be a Connect Center. You exchange the card for a fresh baked treat and also a voucher for a free large pizza. Let's give our guests a warm Harvest welcome. Amen. Man, let's open up in prayer. Father, we just thank you for who you are this morning. We thank you for being the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. We honor, and we're just thankful for you, and we're grateful for everything you've done in our life. We're grateful that you brought us here in your presence this morning. And Lord, we ask you to open up our mind and our hearts to receive the word of God. Amen. The word of God that will make us stronger in the faith, would direct us and protect us and increase our strength in you. And Lord, we pray that the Holy Spirit be poured out in this service this morning in your mighty name. And we thank you right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Our message today, our title theme is Country Music Faith. Amen. Country Music Faith. So I'm excited about what God, the word God has for us today. At this time, give the Lord Jesus a hand clap of praise as Pastor Williams come out.
Well, good morning. Listen, don't get too used to Long Black Train. That will not be a regular part of the worship team's repertoire, okay? One time only, I made them do that. They were like, come on, no, really? Yeah, we got to do that, just one time. And I'll be able to demonstrate to you later when I'm preaching why we did that song and why we're in this theme of country music faith today. Pastor John, if you think it's strange to try to open up a worship service following Long Black Train, if you think that's strange, let me tell y'all what happened to me one time. In a galaxy far away from here, I was a pastor, and I was an amateur pastor, I should say, because I didn't ask enough questions. And on this particular Sunday, I was told that morning by the worship pastor that her nephew was going to bring the Sunday morning special, the solo, right before I preach. That's great. We're going to worship Jesus today. You know, I've got this good attitude. Because at that point, this juncture in my ministry life, I had been convicted of God and I had determined, you know what, whether I like the music or not, I'm going to worship Jesus. Even if they're leading songs from the Hee-Haw Quartet, I'm still going. But I kid you not, this brother stepped into my pulpit and right before I preached, he sang, "I Believe I Can Fly" by R.B. Kelly. So if you think it's hard to open up a worship service after Long Black Train, you ought to try to preach your message after "I Believe I Can Fly." Not exactly the good spiritual segue I was looking for. Well, I'm taking up too much of your time. Let me get to the business at hand. This morning, I'm privileged to announce to you that this week our church has grown by 3 more church members. Somebody give Jesus some praise. Hallelujah. At this time, we want to welcome into the membership and thank God for them, for Tim and Ruth Nichols. Pastor Tim, would you come and receive these certificates on behalf of you and your lovely spouse? Pastor Tim and Ruth are a great addition to the church family. They've been helping us and being a blessing in the ministry. Love you, brother. And this announcement, I get to do 2 in 1. How many of you know that we have been in a search for a new worship pastor? You know that? Well, the Lord has heard and answered our prayer, and we believe that it's not only a God-sent, but a God-called appointment to Harvest Christian Center. And so officially joining the senior ministry staff May 1st, but actually she's already here and helping us out and is also united with us in church membership. Would you please give a good harvest welcome to Pastor Clara Riggleman? She's been so kind. She's been helping us so much over the last couple of weeks, and we look forward to getting started all on her own starting next Sunday. All right. Well, it's time now to turn our attention towards worshiping the Lord through our giving. And as we're preparing our hearts to give, let me just give you a little bit of an update on Vision 2025. If you've been paying attention to the things I've been explaining to you about Vision 2025, a part of that vision means that we want to be a 300-plus church. We believe that God has called us to be that. Now, we were there last Sunday, but that's Easter Sunday. And y'all see, that ain't happening today, right? It could fool me in the 11 o'clock, but as of right now, I don't feel like we're hitting 300. Don't mean to be like little faith here, but please understand, though, I believe that God has called us to grow and reach more and more people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. I know it's not all about numbers, but could I tell you, if you're one, then you matter. Every one matters. If Jesus taught us anything in the Gospel of Luke chapter 15, it's the value of one. And therefore, I count every one because every soul matters. So being a 300 plus church is a part of Vision 2025. But I also believe that by Easter of 2025, a part of Vision 2025 is that we're able to retire this mortgage. Amen. And so I wanted to give you this update and help you to see what your giving has done. We've been receiving the resurrection offering, and that's still open through the end of this month. But so far, we have raised $24,000 that will go directly to the principal of that mortgage. All right, as we continue to worship the Lord, let me invite you to stand with me today. Let's get ready to give the Lord of our tithes and our offerings. As I simply give you this admonition, remember the words of the Lord Jesus that he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Amen. Our Father in heaven, we thank you that as we stand in your presence, Lord, your blessings rest upon your people. Lord, we declare that we are a blessed people, that the favor of God rests upon us. And today we choose to worship you with our tithes and with our offerings as we give glory and honor to the name of Jesus Christ. And all the congregation said, amen. Let's give to the Lord and let's worship him today.
Every time I tried to make it on my own, every time I tried to stand and start to fall, lonely roads that I have traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I had came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been, where I'm going, even when I didn't know it, I couldn't see it. Jesus. For this man who needs amazing kind of grace, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. In the valley,
there was Jesus.
In the shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
In the fire and the floods,
there was Jesus.
All his years and all his
I'm not afraid. is Jesus.
Oh God, we love you. Oh God, we worship you. We love you, Lord. Holy Spirit, come, oh Jesus, take your place among us. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
To thee, how great thou art.
more time. Give me that chorus. How great thou art.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee.
May be seated this morning. Wow, that's as close as I get to be as being a part of the worship team. Just a few moments at a time, you know, try to keep it less than 60 seconds so that we don't cause anybody to leave the campus. But nonetheless, I'm excited to talk to you today about country music faith. Of course, you know that last Sunday was Easter Sunday, and for many Christians around the world, that meant they were in church. There were creative presentations given, such as what we had, that beautiful drama that our team put together. There were many amens as we celebrated the resurrection of Jesus Christ around this globe, and I'm so grateful for that. But as well, last Sunday, you were told that I would be preaching today about country music faith. Now, how many of you, when you first heard that announcement, you thought, where in the world is he going with this? Anybody? I only saw three hands raised. So most of you just, okay, well, we already knew he was crazy. nothing he can do can shock us now. It's like, well, I didn't mean to shock you, but I want to talk to you about something that I believe is important. And that's what it really means to live a life of surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ, and a life that really just worships him, not just on Sundays with the corporate body, but a lifestyle of worship. And so really that's the theme that I'm aiming for today. But I am going to talk to you about country music for just a little bit, if you can handle that. Can you handle it? I kind of feel like you guys are the right crowd. I mean, if I was like deep in the center of Pensacola, maybe they couldn't figure that out and handle it. But you folks in Cantonment, you know, I just feel like y'all can do it. I'm going to be honest with you, but before we moved to Cantonment, I don't think Caleb had a country twang, you know, it didn't take long, and wow. Well, the Holy Spirit does instruct us to worship God with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. There's two different verses that are very similar that tell us that. Colossians 3:16 and Ephesians 5:19 that you find towards the end of your New Testament and all those short letters that the Apostle Paul was being used by the Holy Spirit to write and build the church. And the truth is, if you've spent much time around me over the last 3.5 years, then you've probably figured it out. I like music. Now, that doesn't mean I can sing. That doesn't mean I can play anything. I can play the radio, and I can move the dial back and forth. I used to be pretty good at fine-tuning. Remember when you used to have to fine-tune your radio stations? That tells my age, right? Where you didn't have a digital radio that locked it in, and you had the hi-fi even at your house, and you had to slowly move. I got good at that. I do have some skills. Nonetheless, I'm not a musician, I'm not a singer, but I am a great fan of music overall, and to be honest with you, I have an appreciation for music from all genres, and I hope that just doesn't mess up your mind about what you think, you know, a perfect pastor is supposed to be about, because I think I kind of ruined and burst that bubble a long time ago that I'm not your perfect pastor, but I'm the one that God called to be here. I do have some familiarity with music of all genres and all decades, and I have to confess to you this morning, you've probably already figured this out, I do like some country music. I do like some country music. But that doesn't mean you have to like country music in order to get today's message. I've already heard from some of you over the last week or two, like, I don't like country music. I don't even know if I want to go that Sunday. I don't like country. If I have to sing country music, I mean, come on, this wasn't that bad, was it? I mean, it was just kind of a nice change up. I mean, these were songs they haven't done before, so I was very proud of them for being able to pull that off. I mean, wow. So I like some country music, and I have a feeling that some of you do too, because some of you really were just like me. You were enjoying that song set, that music set they did for us. And some of you are like thinking, should I raise my hand to Jesus or not here? Should I get excited about this? They said Jesus, and I really want to worship him today, but I don't know nothing about a long black train. And some of you just kind of torn in between. Let me name some country music titles, and you know, I know some of you are trying to keep this undercover that you like country music too, but let's just go ahead and come out and just see what happens, okay? I'm going to talk about some song titles of country music through the decades, and if you recognize them, you don't have to have been alive when the song came out, but if you recognize these song titles, make a little bit of noise. Maybe you'll raise a hand. Maybe you'll make a little noise. I don't know what you'll do. Starting in the 1950s, there was an individual by the name of Hank Williams Sr., and he sang, "Hey, good looking. I knew it. Y'all gave it away on the first song title." How many of you just followed that up? When I said, "Hey, good looking," y'all said, "What you got cooking?" Okay, see, you've heard of that one. But then Tennessee Ernie Ford loaded us up with 16 tons and what do you get? Yeah, another day older and you don't want to do that, okay? Don't do that. Don't go deeper in debt every day of your life. In the 1960s, Patsy Cline, she went crazy, okay? Roger Miller became the king of the road, and Glenn Campbell went to work as the Wichita lineman. He was a lineman for the county. Okay. Some of you are going to pick him up slowly but surely. By the 1970s, Lynn Anderson had assured us. She said, "I never promised you." Some of you must have already read my notes. Wow. But Charlie Pride was traveling, and I think he might have been hitching because he said, "Is anybody going to San Antonio?" Yeah, some of you even knew that one. Wow. The 1980s produced some pretty good country music. Barbara Mandrell told us, "I was country when country." I'm definitely in the right church today, Jesus. I done heard from you. But Lee Greenwood in the 80s, he began to pray, "God bless the USA." And you all love that song because it just makes you feel so patriotic. But Keith Whitley in the 80s, he said he liked it best when you say
nothing at all.
Nothing at all. And then Randy Travis saying, "I'm going to love you forever and ever."
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Y'all was kind of wishing they was going to sing that one today, right? Yeah. But then George Strait ended the 80s by going to Amarillo by morning. In the 1990s, Trisha Yearwood told us she's in love with the boy, while Garth Brooks told us about his unanswered prayers. But Vince Gill gave us a funeral song that has become the too often played funeral song in the Southeast, "Go Rest High on That Mountain." Yeah. The 2000s were pretty good too, y'all, and this will be my last decade, as Rascal Flatts sang, "God Bless the Broken Road." Tim McGraw recommended you live like you were. Then Josh Turner used some spiritual imagery to tell us about a long black train that we should avoid. And then one of my favorites from the 2000s is a song by Montgomery Gentry that just says, "Some people change." Some country music, as you've picked up, really is okay. Some country music tells a good story, has some harmless lyrics, some good melodies, and some country music is actually positive enough and does have enough positive messages that it's not going to just like take you straight to hell on the long black train, okay? Some of it is like, okay, but I understand I'm talking about a very thin slice of it. Okay, and I'm really talking about that when I talk about all of secular music. There's a very thin slice of it that is positive enough and has enough spiritual and biblical content that you could be like, okay, and not go to hell because you knew the lyrics of that song. At least I hope not for some of you. Amen? But the truth of the matter, what I want to point out to you is that country music should not be your lifeline. Country music faith is not the same thing as biblical faith. Just like your news channels and your social media feeds, country music should not be your lifeline. A country music faith is not a real faith. It's not a genuine faith. Country music faith is just bringing in so much of the worldly culture that is outside of living a life with a relationship with Jesus Christ, and it can lead you astray. Alas, so much of modern Christianity is really cultural and not really biblical. And that's what I want to warn you about today. Raise your hands and try to answer this question if you're not already under conviction. If you can handle country music, surely you can handle a cup of coffee. Amen? Who in here drinks your coffee black? Straight black. Come on. Let me engage the house right quick. You drink your coffee straight up black. Don't put nothing in my coffee, right? I used to drink it, you know, with all types of additives. Let's talk about that. How many of you drink coffee, but you add one thing to it? Okay. You're not ashamed of that? I can drink it black or just give me a little creamer. Most of the time, most mornings, I'm just drinking my coffee black. But now how many of you pour a cup of coffee, but you only pour it about half full because you've got so many additives in that stuff, so many additions, that it's not even really coffee by the time you drink it. It just tastes like a drink that used to be coffee. I mean, we don't know what that stuff is. I mean, you step up to the line at your favorite coffee shop, and, you know, you have to have a pretty good training as a barista to understand what you're ordering. Because I'm standing here listening to some of these folks order. I'm like, what? I thought this was a coffee shop. I think they just ordered a mixed drink. You know, double shot and two of this and one of those. And then sometimes they'll even say, iced. I'm like, wow. This is a different coffee world. But you know, country music faith is a lot like those coffees that have all these other additives in there. I mean, there's a little bit of Jesus in there, but not really enough to change your life. Country music faith sometimes will just mention a line about prayer or just a line about Jesus. Just enough to make you feel less guilty for listening to it. Country music faith gets you sucked in like that, and you feel like it's a little bit moral, and then you figure out the fella singing about two girlfriends or a wife and a girlfriend and his dog that just died, and you're wondering what in the world happened to his pickup truck. Come on, y'all never heard that one? I mean, and you begin to feel sorry about these guys, but you know, they said Jesus in the song, so they must be okay people. We must understand. Whether we're talking about within the body of Christ or outside of the body of Christ, musicians and preachers and people who are on stages performing should never be lifted up in our eyes to where we think they're better than Jesus. And I know that's not you, but there are some people that they worship entertainers. We live in a society, in a culture that is filled with many idols. And today, I'm just simply trying to kick down the idol of country music. I'm telling you, you can enjoy it a little bit, but you know what? You don't have to let it be a high place in your life where it comes above a real biblical-based relationship with Jesus Christ. A lot of people, when it comes to really knowing Jesus, they don't. Everybody that talks about Jesus doesn't worship the same Jesus. Some people treat Jesus like the old-timers used to treat this specific product in the 50s and 60s. It was about a hair gel, and they said, a dab will do you. And that's all some people have of Jesus. They have just a dab will do you, and it's a culturally based religion. They've got a friend or two who's Christian, and when they get in trouble, they're not stupid. They know they should pray. I mean, obviously, they're not dumb. They know to pray when they get in trouble. They go to church when it's convenient. They add a sprinkle of Jesus here, a sprinkle there. They want to appear to be religious and do just enough to make you think that they're Christian, but they're really not Christian. They're not really living a life that is surrendered to the Lord Jesus Christ. Please grab a hold of this truth that I want you to know. Culturally based religion lacks the power to really change your life. If you really want something that's going to change your life, friend, you need to get into a life-saving, life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. I want to get into some scripture this morning because I believe that genuine faith is found and shown to us, demonstrated through the power of the Holy Scriptures. The Bible actually does show us what it looks like when we live for and follow Jesus. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verses 14 and 15 and 17 and 18. And I selected these from the J.B. Phillips translation. If that offends you, wow, if that's the only thing that offended you about this service, then we probably got issues. But the reality is, whether you look at this in the J.B. Phillips or you look at it somewhere, you're going to get the same meaning that I'm trying to share with you today, okay? The very spring of our actions is the love of Christ. We look at it like this. If one died for all men, then, in a sense, they all died. And his purpose in dying for them is that their lives should now be no longer lived for themselves, but for him who died and rose again for them. For if a man is in Christ, he becomes a new person altogether. The past is finished and gone. Everything has become fresh and new. All this is God's doing, for he has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. Pay attention one more time to the words in bold, okay? The people who are in Christ, their lives should now be no longer lived for themselves, but for him who died and rose again for them. Raise your hand in this congregation today if you believe that at some point in your life you have clearly heard the good news of Jesus Christ. Not a hard question. Most of you should say, yeah, I've heard it. You know, you raised a hand because you understand the historical evidence that the gospel of Jesus Christ is true. You've heard that he was born of a virgin, that he lived a sinless life, that he died for our sins and was raised again the third day. You've heard that. But here's the interesting thing that came across my desk this week as I was studying and preparing for this message. There was some research completed by the Pew Research Center that says 75% of Americans identified themselves as Christian in the year 2015. 2015, 75%. And that was pre-COVID, right? So just wanted to place that for you. Pre-COVID, 2015, 75% of Americans, according to the Pew Research Center's research, identified themselves as Christians. By the year 2020, they did another study, and it indicated that that number had dropped from 75% to 65%. But this ain't 2020, is it? This is 2022. And so let's just presume that things were getting worse and sliding off. You know, some of you got such a negative mindset, you always assume the worst. You always think everything's getting worse than it actually is. But let's just go along in that line of thinking this morning and just presume that, you know, this ain't 2020, this is 2022, and let's presume that it's no longer 65%. Let's just say maybe now it's only 60% of people in our country would actually identify themselves as Christians. Okay, well, if that's true, according to my presumption, then that means 6 out of 10 people you know would probably label themselves and identify themselves as Christian. And doesn't that just kind of make you smile in your heart? I don't mean like a warm, fuzzy feeling. I mean just like, really? You mean to tell me 6 out of 10 people in my country are Christian? You see, I'm not trying to get political with you, but I just happen to believe myself that if 6 out of 10 people in our nation were thoroughly individually Christian and had a relationship with God through his son Jesus Christ, that our nation would not look near as divided as it does. It would be more united for the cause of Christ instead of division that the body of Christ often creates, promotes, and fuels within our nation. I'm not trying to tell you that you should be an American Christian. I'm trying to tell you, and what I've been trying to teach you for about 3.5 years now, is that you should be a Christian American. There's a big difference. The Christian American understands that we have a citizenship that is not of this world. The Christian American understands that my priorities do not rest in serving this country. My priorities rest in the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and his name is Jesus Christ. I'm going to follow his admonition. He told me to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Therefore, I cannot afford to get my mind entrapped and entangled with all the goings on in this world. I've got to make sure that I'm living for Jesus, that I'm living a life of surrender and committed relationship with him, that other people see it and they want that same thing too. I've won some arguments before about politics and about music and about sports, but every time I've won an argument, I've lost my opportunity to witness to that person about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So I've determined about the things of this world, I'm not going to be so well adjusted. I can be wrong about the things of this world so that I can be right about the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So what are you trying to tell me today, preacher? I'm trying to tell you stop settling for a culturally based Christianity. It's so shallow. It's not biblical. You can have the real deal, and it's found in Jesus Christ and in the Word of God. You see, real faith doesn't just add a little Jesus. It fully surrenders to Him. Real faith is based on Easter being 100% true. Real faith believes Jesus' gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Real faith hears His word, keeps His word, and abides in the word, knowing that that is the truth that keeps you free. Glory to His name. Let us remember in the beginning. Take you back to the beginning. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created mankind. And He made them male and female, okay? And God created us to be in a relationship with Himself. Now, the unique thing about this we must remember is that God gave us a free will. God did not make mankind to be little robots whereby the love and obedience that there would just be forced upon us. No, we got to choose. And Adam and Eve had the power of choice. But if you've read the Bible, you know they chose wrong. And with their sin came original sin. And through their disobedience, sin came to humanity. But God made a way for that sin to be corrected. God made a way for that sin to be done away with. And His way is called Jesus Christ, the original priest, the great high priest, the bridge builder who makes a bridge between sinful man and holy God and says, because of my shed blood that washes your sins away, you can be returned to a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's real faith. That's the beginning. You understand that the real life, historically accurate account of Jesus Christ proves He is who He said He was. He is God with us, who became God for us as He gave His life's blood at Calvary. And so a surrendered life that I'm talking to you about today has received His forgiveness and lives in a committed relationship with Him, as evidenced by the following. When we have real faith, we recognize our sin and accept His grace. Romans 3, 23 through 25 tells us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over former sins. Well, that ought to make somebody shout to realize God has passed over your sins because of the shed blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus Himself. You see, this is where surrender begins for real faith and a relationship with God. If anybody's going to get right with God, and anybody plans on going to heaven when they leave this life, friend, the first thing you've got to do is recognize your sin and accept God's grace. Because you'll never be able to work hard enough. You'll never be able to live good enough. You'll never be able to be religious enough to make sure that your sin problem is taken care of. It could only be taken care of by one, and His name is Jesus. When we have real faith, secondly, we turn away from willful sin. Now, I'm a holiness preacher, and there's no way I could let you learn about a surrendered life without telling you this, okay? When we have real faith in Jesus Christ, we turn away from things in our life that we know are wrong. We turn away from willful sin. The Spirit explains this to us in Romans chapter 6. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? We know that our old self was crucified with Him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Romans 8 continues, and it insists, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has made me free from the law of sin and death. So sometimes here's what I hear from Christians. But I can't help myself. Friends, you can help yourself. If you're truly been born again, the Spirit of God will help you to help yourself. It ain't all about your own willpower, but it's about the willpower of the Holy Spirit. And if you're His, He will help you. When you say, I can't help myself, you're probably telling a lie to God because you don't want to help yourself and cooperate with the evidence and the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. But if you'll choose to surrender and cooperate with Him, you do not have to live a life of willful sin. I understand some things are harder to break than others, but I want to tell you, through the power of prayer and you transforming your mind by the Word of God, you can be changed to the glory of God. Somebody say amen. Amen. I simply tell you this, and I think I tell it to you in many different ways, forms, and fashions through most of my sermons, but it's not God's will for the Christian to continue in willful sin. Let every man that names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Thirdly, if you're living a life of real surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ, here's what it looks like. When we have real faith, we give up going our own way. And some people are like, but preacher, I like my own way. Well, you can go your own way, but the end thereof are the ways of death. And you won't like the death that I'm talking about here. I'm talking about a death that is an eternal separation from Jesus Christ. But when we have real faith, we give up going our own way. I thank God for the reality of the Holy Spirit that impressed upon my heart that, you know what, my ways were horrible ways. And the ways that I was trying to go was going to land me in so much trouble and sorrow and anguish in this life and in the eternity to come. Thank God for that day. When we have real faith, we give up going our own way. Jesus says in Matthew 16, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So to give up going your own way means that as a child of God, you've got to forsake selfishness. Nothing makes you appear to be more anti-Christian than when you act with a selfish spirit. So understand, giving up going your own way means that you're going to go God's way and not your own way. And it's a rebuke to the selfish nature that we were born with. It's a life that's lived for the one who died for you and rose again from the grave. Some of you are thinking right now, even as I'm preaching, is that even possible, preacher? Yes. The born-again child of God can say, because of the Spirit of Christ within him, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The reason that many of us have failed this and have not been able to do this, given up going our own way, is because we're trying to do it in our own strength. You know, it has to be a daily confession of mine. You know what? Jesus, I need your help. God, I need your grace and your mercy today. Lord, today, yesterday's gone, but today's a new day. And Lord, I know that if you don't help me, I'm going to fail. There's no way I can be the man of God. There's no way I can be the husband and the father. There's no way I can be the servant of God you've called me to be, Jesus, if you don't help me, Lord. I need to not go my own way, but Lord, I want to go your way. I find the Word of God tells me in Romans chapter 8, verse 11, if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. There is a life-giving, a quickening power of the Holy Spirit that's available to the child of God, that if we will live surrendered, He will help us to go God's way and not our own way. I'm telling you, God's way is the best way. So, Christian, what I'm really trying to tell you is this. Don't be so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. Many people tell me they're Christian. Many people say they believe in God, but their behavior doesn't yet demonstrate a committed relationship to Jesus Christ. You see, real faith doesn't just add a little Jesus. It fully surrenders to Him. A genuine Christian life will never fully agree with the ways of this world that oppose the righteous leadership of God's people. Some sincerely say, and I believe they mean it when they say, preacher, I believe in God. And I believe they mean in their heart of hearts, I believe in the one true God. I believe there really is a God. They say that. And I believe they mean it. Consider James chapter 2, verses 19 through 20 from the Message Bible. It reads, do I hear you professing to believe in the one and only true God, but then observe you complacently sitting back as if you had done something wonderful? That's just great. Demons do that. But what good does it do them? Use your heads. Do you suppose for a minute that you can cut faith and works in two and not end up with a corpse on your hands? The good news is that the grace of Jesus Christ is extended to us this day. And if you realize today, hey, I'm not really where I ought to be. I mean, I thank God I'm not where I used to be, but I realize that my form of Christianity is maybe not that wholly committed. It's really not that lifestyle that really is helping others to come to faith in Jesus Christ. It's not a fully surrendered life. I've really just been sprinkling a little bit of Jesus into my life, just like them country music songs sometimes sprinkle a little bit of Jesus, and you can barely recognize anything moral there except for they said the name of Jesus. Friend, if that describes you today, the good news is God has grace to you. He loves you right where you are, but he loves you too much to leave you right where you are. And today, I want you to hear the Savior say to you, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The surrendered life is a life that's done striving. The surrendered life and a committed relationship with Jesus Christ is not working to be right with God, but at rest. In the peace of God, knowing it's only by his grace that I'm saved. It's only by his grace that I'm going to grow and be sanctified. It's only by his grace that I'm going to actually be changed and transformed by the power of his word. I'm going to ask you to stand here in just a few minutes. Not yet, but when I do, I want you to take into consideration something. In this invitation today, I believe that the Holy Spirit would have us be divided into four different groups. And in these four different groups, I pray to God that you're in the first or the second group. But if you're in the third or the fourth group, I want you to know I've already prayed for you and I'll continue to pray for you. Because that burdens my heart. The first group of people say, I have a relationship with God and I'm actively following Jesus' ways. If that describes you, could I just see a hand very quickly? It doesn't matter who sees. We're not judging one another. God is our judge. Amen. Thank you. Then that second group might say, I wasn't actively following the ways of Jesus when I walked in, but I want to do better. I want to start that relationship, and I really want to follow Jesus with all that I can. If that describes you, maybe you just quickly say, yeah, you know what? I know I can do better. I want to do better. Yeah, that's my heart. I want to do better. And then the third and the fourth group, some would say, I'm a Christian. But I'm not really interested in following Jesus' ways. Friend, that scares me for you. I'm not so sure how long you'll be able to say I am a Christian if you don't quickly get a change of heart and begin to follow the ways of Jesus. And then fourthly, sadly, some of you here today may say I'm not a Christian and I don't yet have a desire to follow Jesus. For those of you who might place yourself in that third or that fourth group, I want you to know you're not by yourself. I used to be there. If you had asked me a long time ago, I probably would have told you when I was 18, 19, yeah, I'm a Christian. But my life didn't look like a Christian. Even when I was 20 years old, my life didn't really look like a Christian life should look like. I probably did more harm to the body of Christ than I did help. That's my confession to you. And everyone else that's in this congregation that raised their hands as a part of number one and number two, they'd also have to say, you know what? There was a time in my life when I knew I wasn't where I needed to be with God. But I thank God for his grace and his mercy that drew me into a right relationship with him. They're going to sing, and during this invitational song, I want you to get your heart prepared to respond to the invitation. Now, don't act like you're in a hurry today, okay? Listen to Pastor Wynn. I ain't preached long. We ain't even been in this room for an hour yet, okay? But I want every one of us to make sure we obey the voice of the Lord. If the Holy Spirit's dealing with you, I'm going to ask at the end of this invitational song that you would join with me in an altar of prayer. Let us sing.
Of his name, oh. This man of which I speak is here today for you and me. His name is Jesus. You can call him as you please. You call him Emmanuel, the King of all kings. He's the Son of the Father, the Prince of Peace. They call him Hosanna, alas at sea. He's the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me. Times I've called his name, pray for forgiveness when used in vain. Oh, but there's a peace in knowing his forgiveness stays the same. Most famous in his story, things he spoke, the whole world still reads. His name is Jesus.
As the prayer team is coming down, I assure you that these Christ followers are not here to judge you. They're not going to look at you askew or any way with judgment today. They're just going to simply believe God with you. And if there's a need in your life, and you'd say, you know what, I know I'm saved, but there's a great need in my life, I'm burdened about this, they'd love to pray with you. Okay. But I want to ask every one of you, regardless of which one of those four groups you said, hey, that's me, I'm in that group. There's a need of prayer for all of us. Today, if you need to get restored to a right relationship with God, they'd love to pray with you. But if you just want to kneel down on an altar by yourself, Jesus will meet you there. We're going to continue to sing and worship, but this invitation is up to you now. It's on you to respond and obey the voice of the Holy Spirit. Let us worship Him. Let's respond. Let's come to Jesus.
Seeks my soul.
Great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Somebody shout hallelujah with me on the count of three. One, two, three. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He is wondrous to be praised. Could we give it just one more time? Could we just go back through how great they are just one more time? If you're comfortable with doing it, just gently raise your hands. It won't hurt. And give God a little bit of praise, a little bit of glory.
Then sings my soul.
My soul.
encourage you guys that if you're in that number two section that needs to start following and truly doing something with your faith, I want to encourage baptism. Last week was Easter, and we had over 10 kids accept Jesus into their hearts and Harvest Kids. And today, our lesson is, should I be baptized? So some of you parents in here may have some kids after this morning come in and say, I want to be baptized. So you're going to get some information about that. But I'm going to pretend y'all are in Harvest Kids for a minute, and we do something in there called What's Up. And whenever the adult says, What's Up, they repeat this motto back to us. So today's What's Up in Harvest Kids is, baptism is a picture of what God's done for me. So we're going to all say it together first. Baptism is a picture of what God done for me. Okay, so now that I'm going to say what's up, and y'all are going to repeat it. What's up?
Baptism is a picture.
Very good. So if you have kids in Harvest Kids this morning, I want you to ask them what's up and see if they can remember it. And maybe they won't remember it, and you will, and that'll surprise them. All right, you guys are dismissed. Have a great day.